إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعة، من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد، ومن يعص الله ورسوله فقد ضل غوى، وإنه لا يضر إلا نفسه ولا يضر الله شيئا. إن خير الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وإن خير الأمور عوازمها، والشر الأمور محدثاتها، كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد، يقول الله عز وجل في كتاب الكريم بعد الأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. ثم ما بعد. Indeed, all praises are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him. We seek His assistance. And to Him, and only Him, do we turn in repentance. We seek the forgiveness in Allah from the evil of ourselves, and from the evil of our actions. And whom shall Allah guides, none can mislead. And whoever is led astray, there is no guide for him. And we all testify that there is none worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we all testify that Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the final and beloved messenger of Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, welcome to Yawm al-Jum'ah, the best day of the week on this beautiful Friday, on this sixth day of Jumad al-Akhir, 1,441 years after the Hijrah of beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For those of you who don't recognize the date, all this means for us inshallah ta'ala is inshallah, we're less than 90 days away from the month of Ramadan. May Allah, Allahumma ballighna Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala allow us to experience the month of Ramadan once more. May Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala, may Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala give us the tawfiq to get stronger before the month of Ramadan. And one of the stories I have for you today is a beautiful story of the Prophet Ayyub alayhi salatu wassalam. In the English, he's referred to as the Prophet Job. May God's peace and blessings be upon him. This is a story, this is a prophet of Allah that he's mentioned in the Quran, but we don't pay much attention to him. But Allah gives us ayats in the Quran about this great prophet of Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala. If you hear about this prophet, one of the main things that you'll see from the story is about patience. It's about being patient, and you'll see the patience that he exhibits. And a lot of people don't know the direct story, everything that takes place with Ayyub alayhi salam, but he goes through a lot. He has a prophetic lineage. He is one of the direct descendants of Ishaq alayhi salatu wassalam, which means that he is a descendant of the great prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam. He has lineage. His mother has lineage, direct lineage to Lut alayhi salatu wassalam. To Lut. The wife of Ayyub alayhi salam, she also has lineage within the prophethood. She is related to the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. And we know from some narrations, her name is Rahmah. And we'll understand why she's referred to as Rahmah, and one of the narrations calls her that she's Rahmah. And you'll see that Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala puts this blessing within her, that she has this blessing of being merciful, being forgiving, being someone who is accepting, very patient, mashallah tabarakallah as well. When we look at the story of the Prophet Ayyub alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala blessed him with a lot of wealth. A lot of wealth. If he was alive today, he'd be extremely wealthy. He has wealth beyond belief. We're talking about land upon land. Stocks of land. When you go and you have farmland, you have chickens and you have cattle and all of the land, mashallah, beautiful, big farms. A lot of jewelry, a lot of property, a lot of houses. See, he was, mashallah, tabarakallah, blessed. Allah blessed him with a lot of wealth. Very good health, mashallah. Very young and fit. It always looked young, even when he was older. He looked like he was a young man. Very fit, mashallah, tabarakallah. If we fast forward to him, And the people, his relationship with the people, impeccable. Impeccable. Very easygoing with the people. Very nice with the people. The people loved him. The people, they would go and gather around him when he was giving his lectures. When they wanted advice, they would go to you, but I said, I'll see. Give me some advice. Give me some advice. Give me some advice, some great advice that I can use. And they would sit with him. Big gathering, mashallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him so much. He gave him health. He gave him wealth. And he gave him the people. And he gave him a lot of offspring. He had a lot of children. In some narrations, he had more than 20 children, subhanAllah. More than 20 children, mashallah. More than 20 children in some of the narrations. But one day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enacts his plan. Enacts his plan. He had a plan for Ayyub alayhi salam. He said that this is a person that is always patient with you. He's always saying Alhamdulillah. Oh, praise and thanks is due to Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to start to test him one thing at a time. The first test that he sends to him is that he tests him with his wealth, with his money. With his money. What do you mean? He takes a business away or something like this? No. He takes everything. No more wealth. He takes his properties away. He takes his land away. He takes his farmland away. He takes his jewelry away. Everything that you can think about. Just think about right now, if you have a bank account, you have a house, you have a car, you have some properties, you have a retirement account, and one day, right now, today, becomes zero. You're on the street. On the street, nowhere to live. No food. You don't even have enough money to buy food for yourself. You just have this one little shack that you live in. That's it. A little box maybe, or a little hut or something like that. That's all he had. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes everything away from him. From extreme wealth to extreme poverty. To extreme poverty. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests him with this. And he sees his reaction. And his first reaction is, Alhamdulillah kullaha. May Allah's praise and thanks in all conditions. Allah is praised and he's thanked in all conditions. Alhamdulillah. That was his first test. Ayyub alayhi salam passes. Second test. Now he tests him with his children, his offspring. Remember I told you he had more than 20 children in certain narrations. Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala, while he's alive, these kids, little age to a little bit elderly age, one by one, each of the offspring is taken away from Ayyub alayhi salam. Each of the offspring, each of his children are taken away. In front of his eyes, right in front of his eyes, while he's still alive, one by one, every single child is taken away. Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala sees this man. And now he sees him in this condition. What does he say? He says, Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. To Allah these children belong, and Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala has called these children back to himself. Allahu Akbar. Second test. The first test was wealth, all the wealth taken away. Second test, children, all the children taken away, and alhamdulillah, cool. Of course he's sad. There's sadness in that, but he's cool. Meaning he's cool with Allah. He had that relationship with Allah, and that relationship with Allah did not change. He still praised him, he still thanked him. What do? When we go into the littlest of situations, Ya Allah, you're going to give me this. That's it, I'm done. I'm not praying anymore. The third test, and this was the most difficult test. And it's a two-part test. He tests him with his health. First, the outward health, outside. He starts to give him a skin disease. A skin disease, a visible skin disease. It's all over, it's all on his face. People can see it. And what happens? Now outwardly, he's sick. And then when he goes to his gatherings, those same people that loved him, those same people that want to listen to him, now those people are like, he's got a sickness. I don't want to be near him. I want to catch that sickness from him. Whether realizing it's contagious or not, not even inquiring about it, the people left him. The people left him. The people in there are no more. They've gone away. They're like, we don't want to have this disease. The same people that listened to him for advice, and they were doing very well, mashallah, tabarakallah. Now the person who's giving them advice, because he has some problem with his skin, he's sick. To go away. That was the first part of that test of health. That was the outward test. Now the inward test, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends him a disease internally where his organs are all messed up and now he's bedridden. He cannot get up anymore. He cannot do anything anymore. The only thing that he can do now is his mind works, his tongue works, and his heart works. And he praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa ala after every test. Ya Allah, you have sent this test, alhamdulillah, I accept. Ya Allah, have mercy on me. Forgive me. Forgive me. Now he's bedridden. There's no more support. Everybody's left. His wealth is gone. His children are gone. His outward health is gone. His inward health is gone. And he's just saying, alhamdulillah at all times. Alhamdulillah kulli hal. Praise and thanks to Allah at all times. No support. No neighbor. No nothing. No one. Everybody around him has left him. Except for one person. His wife. His wife, Rahma. His wife, Rahma, stays. She is the one who supports him. She takes care of him. She herself was wealthy, meaning she had some wealth from prior to marriage, and during the marriage she had saved up something. Whatever else they had left over from her side, she started to sell her property, whatever she needed to do. She started to take that money and spent it on Ayyub alayhi salam for his food, for his water, for his medications, to take care of him. Day and night. This is a body that just lays there and can't do much except for utter a few words. Utter words. That's all he can do. So this wife supports him all throughout. Spends as much. After a little time now, the money runs out. Money's finished. She spent all of it on herself. And she spent it all on Ayyub alayhi salam to take care of him. Food, water, medication, health-wise, whatever he needed, cleanliness. She took care of it all. MashaAllah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to have wives like this. Allahumma ameen. This is a beautiful wife. Now she knows that she needs money. What is she going to do? She goes around to the neighbors and she asks them, hey, is there some type of chore that I can complete for you? Is there some type of housework that I can complete on your behalf? And so she started to do chores to collect money to take care of Ayyub alayhi salam. To take care of Ayyub alayhi salam. So she gets some money. She gets the money, she takes care of herself and Ayyub alayhi salam, food, water, medication, and whatever else they can afford. Very little money. Then the people started to find out as Ayyub alayhi salam's condition is worsening, Ayyub alayhi salam's condition is worsening, they find out that this is the wife of Ayyub alayhi salam. He's sick, he's worsening, Allah doesn't love him, Allah doesn't care about him, because if Allah loved him, Allah cared about him, he wouldn't put him in that condition, right? People, mentality, judgmental, right? All of us. We don't know what he has. Oh, keep my kids away from him, keep yourself away from him. Wife is close to him, stays with him. He has a disease. She must be a carrier. No work for you. No more work for you. So they basically said that we don't need your assistance. We don't need your assistance, Ya Rahma. We didn't need any. Alhamdulillah, we're good. The people reject her. The same people that these people were advising and making it easy for the people, they have left the Prophet of Allah and his wife by themselves. No money whatsoever. She goes back to Ayyub alayhi salam, she complains to him and tells him that the people don't hire me, I can't get any more work, I can't do any of these things, I cannot bring any more food, I cannot bring any more water for you, your medications are behind because the people are not giving me work and I don't have anything to do. And then she says to him, she asks him a question. She says to him, she asks him, how long is this going to last? Ayyub alayhi salam, angry, extremely upset with Rahma. How can you ask me this type of question? Then he asks her, how long when we were in good state, how long did that good state last? When we were healthy, when we were wealthy, when we were doing everything and we had that state, how long were we in a good position? She says, 80 years. And then he says, how long has this test been going on? How long have these afflictions come in from Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala? And she says, just the last 7 years. He goes, how can you compare 80 years of greatness, goodness, to those 7 years of misery? They don't even equal up. They're not even up to par. We have to be patient. He said, if I get cured, if I was healthy, I'd lash you 100 lashes. I'd whip you 100 times. He says this to his wife, because she's being impatient with Allah. He's being patient with Allah. He's saying his decree with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is such that he's being extremely patient. Extremely patient. And he expects that same patience out of her. But she's not exhibiting that patience. She's getting restless. She wants to have her life back. She wants to go back to normal. wants this. She doesn't need to be wealthy, extremely wealthy, but have a steady flow of income. Have a job. Be able to pay your rent. Be able to, you know, get your own food and water and medications. And so this goes on for a little while. And then a day comes about where now they have nothing. And she needs to come up with this money. She needs to come up with this money. At this time, there was a practice of the people that they would take some of their hair and they would clip it off and they sell it and they get some money for it. They take their hair. So a lock of hair. So one day she decided to go and sell, cut off a lock of her hair and sell it. And she received some money for it from one of her friends. Or one of her friends bought it. You know, people do, even this today works, right? People make wigs and people do different things with it. When she got this money, it lasted a little while. She bought some food, water, medications for Ayyub alayhi salam, and her own needs were met with this money. After a little while, this money was going to run out too, but when Ayyub alayhi salam realized that there's money coming into the house, she's complaining that there's no work, there's no job. Where is this money coming from? She didn't want to lie because she knows that Ayyub alayhi salam is going to get angry with her, and he didn't want her to be upset with her. And she just makes up an excuse and she said that I did some chores and I was able to receive some money for those chores. In the chore of cutting her hair off. She didn't have to lie. She didn't lie. So she got the money. And now this money runs out again. What to do now? What to do now? She said it worked once. It worked once. She now decides to take the rest of her hair off. Shave it all off. She takes all of her hair, everything off. She's covered herself. She sells all of this. She gets some money. And now Ayyub alayhi salam knows something's up. She comes back home. He's in bed. And he's watching her and sees she's covered. And he said, where are you getting this money from? What type of chores? People are not hiring you. You're complaining. They're not, you know, they're not doing anything. Loans from anywhere. Nothing. Nobody's willing to touch you. Nobody's willing to come near you. Nobody wants to speak to you. You're all by yourself. And then he basically prods her and makes a promise that you have to tell me. You have to tell me. You have to tell me. You're not going to tell me, she said. She unveils herself. And he sees her shaved head. And at this point in time, Ayyub alayhi salam did not complain before this. He did not ask for any mercy. He did not ask for any forgiveness. At this time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that Ayyub, إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ أَنِّي مَسَّنِي ضُرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ He calls out to us, and he calls out to us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, that he makes this dua that is immortalized in the Qur'an. Immortalized in the Qur'an, رَبِّي أَنِّي مَسَّنِي ضُرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ We have been touched by an affliction. We have been touched by conflict. We have been touched by this. Ya Allah, you are the most merciful of mercy. Anyone who can give mercy, you are the absolute merciful one. This is the dua. He still does not ask from his patience, from his wisdom, from his words. Ya Allah, just cure me. But he is saying, Ya Allah, you are the most merciful of mercy. When Ayyub alayhi salam makes this dua, Allah accepts. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ And we answer him. And we answer him. And how does he, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, answer? It's a beautiful question that was in Surah Sa'd. He says, وَذْكُرْ عَبْدَنَا أَيُّوبِ Mention the story of Ayyub alayhi salatu wasalam, the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ أَنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الشَّيْطَانُ بِنُصْبٍ وَعَذَابٍ Ya Rabb, the shaytan has touched us. They've caused conflict amongst us. Meaning, he has hurt me, and he has caused this hurt to me. He has caused this pain to me, this affliction to me. Ya Allah, he has caused this infliction to me. Ya Allah, cure this. Ya Allah, make it easy. Make it go away. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him an answer. He now gives him the strength to stand up, and he stands. And Allah subhanahu jalla wa ala in the ayah, next ayah says, Urkud bi rijlik. Urkud bi rijlik. Bang your foot into the ground. Into the ground. هذا مغتسل بارد وشراب. A spring of cold water will erupt. And as you, if we were to witness this in our own, when he does this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows water, cold water, to come out from a spring from underneath his feet. And Allah commands him to take this water and rub it on your body. And as he's rubbing it on the body, those same things, the skin disease that you had as he's rubbing in his body, the skin now is getting purified. It is now getting cured. Then he's ordered to drink this water, this cold water. You know what, let us know when you're thirsty? You don't want warm water. I'm talking about nice, cool water. I'm not talking about ice cold water from the fridge or the freezer. I'm talking about natural springs. When you go to the mountains and you go grab a cup of water, a glass of water, it's extremely cold. And when you drink it, this is a spring that Allah sends him. This spring comes about, he rubs it, his skin is cured. When he drinks it, the organs come back to normal. The organs come back to normal. Now he's renewed again. This is like the fountain of youth stories that we hear about. This is the fountain of youth story that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about in the Quran. He's sitting there, nice, back to normal. Almost like he's back to young age. His wife comes back home. She goes, Have you seen the servant of Allah? Ayyub alayhi salam. He goes, It's me? He goes, she's absolutely disturbed right now. She had to go through a lot. She's like, I don't have time for jokes. He goes, no, Allah's listened to us. He's cured us. He's cured me. I have my health back again. وَمِثْلَهُمْ مَعَهُمْ رَحْمَةً مِنَّا وَذِكْرَانِ مِنَ الْبَابِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the story of Ayyub alayhi salam in Surah Sa'd in 3 or 4 ayahs. Very simple. And he says that we return them to their prior state. Him with his health and his wife and his children were restored to him. Those 20 plus children that I told you about, now he has double the children. Subhanallah. Patience, Ya Akhwat Islam, pays off. Property, wealth is back. His health is back. He's back. Because he waited for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He exhibited patience and Allah blesses him in this world. Because he did not go. Our first reaction is always, oh man, again, another problem, another musibah. When you say this is denying the qadr of Allah. This is a problematic. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses our brothers and our sisters who are patient with him. And then we have one more thing left over. So he has everything back, but now he made that qasam, that oath. He made that oath that he's going to whip her 100 times if he was cured. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him in the next ayah what to do with that as well. وَخُذْ بِيَدِكَ ضِغْفًا فَضْرِبْ بِهِ وَلَا تَحْنَثْ إِنَّا وَجَدْنَاهُ صَابِرًا نِعْمَ الْعَبْدِ إِنَّهُ أَبْوَابٌ. Allah subhanahu jalla wa ta'ala says, pick up these grass-like things. Pick up the grass. You still keep your qasam because you made that qasam for us. You did not make a foolish oath. You were patient with our decree and you got angered with our decree. So because you were patient, we are going to give you a way out. You continue with your qasam. You take this grass-like thing and you hit her, you whip her, it's going to tickle her. And you have been extremely patient, mashallah, tabarakallah. Allahu Akbar, Ya Akhwat Islam. Allahu Akbar. This is the beautiful story of Ayyub alayhi salatu wassalam. This is the beautiful story. In Sahih al-Bukhari, Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala sends him, this is the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala sends him golden locusts from Jannah, from paradise, as he was showering. When he saw this and he was showering out in the open, he started to pick up all these golden locusts and he was trying to grab them. Allah says that we have always provided for you. We're going to continue to provide for you. Why are you gathering these? He said, Ya Rabb, you're the most merciful. This is a gift from Jannah. How can I not collect it? Allahu Akbar, Ya Akhwat Islam. SubhanAllah. The beauty of this story, the beauty of our beloved Prophet Ayyub alayhi salatu wassalam. And again, English. This isn't it also, you'll hear that they say that the same Prophet Job, may Allah peace and blessings be upon him in the English. We refer to him as Prophet Ayyub alayhi salatu wassalam. This is the beautiful story, Ya Akhwat Islam, of our beloved Prophet Ayyub alayhi salam and his wife, Rahma. May Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala allow us to learn from this, implement lessons, allow us to strengthen our iman, ya akhwal islam. Every story that we will speak from this point forward, we don't need money, we don't need all of that. We need iman, ya akhwal islam. We're starving for iman. We're starving for strength of iman. We want our iman to be strong, and we want our iman to be an iman that shakes mountains and foundations and pillars of structures of the world. That's what we want. And this is why we're working on the stories of the prophets and other stories of great men and women in the history of Islam, because we want our iman, ya akhwal, Ya Allah, increase us in our iman. Ya Allah, give us the beautiful gift of Nur al-Iman, the light of iman. May Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala guide us. May Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala make it easy for us. Wa qulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullaha li wa lakum wa lisairil mu'minin wal muslimat fastaghfiruhu innahu ghafurur rahim. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة المتقين والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعد ما بعد. Three things, يا أخوي. Three things before we finish our. Number one, when we pray, we should be with complete rows behind the imam. So I'm making a plea right now, so all of you brothers, to please move in as much as you possibly can. If there's brothers that are on the first floor that are easily able to get up to the second floor, please come and help us complete our rows on the first floor right behind the imam, number one. Number two, an announcement that going forward, that the janaz will be taking, the funeral prayers will be taking place at the Bangladesh Community Center.
Muslim Center.
So the janaz, the funeral prayers, will be taking place there. The funeral facilities and everything else will be taking place there. And the third thing, our beloved Sheikh Mustafa, who's one of my teachers as well, Mustafa Al-Zabawi, he will be giving a lesson today after Maghrib.
Isha.
After Isha, inshallah. After Isha today. So please, gather with the Sheikh. He has much knowledge. You can learn so much from him. So please, learn from him. Please come here, sit down with him, and try to learn as much as you possibly can. Half-hour sessions is what I used to do in the city with him in Manhattan, in Masjid Manhattan. And Allahi, look at me today, I'm giving khutbas because he teaches well. He gives you the authentic understanding of the Qur'an and the authentic understanding of the Sunnah. Allah, if you don't understand that, he grabs you with that. He says if you can come up with any type of Sunnah, any type of Hadith, but the ayat of the Qur'an, the improper understanding of it, and if you give it to him, then he'll believe you. What more do you want from a Sheikh, from an Imam, that says this to you, that he believes in the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa sallam and the authentic understanding of the Qur'an? Let's wrap up this khutbah. Three things I have for you for this khutbah. Number one, patience with Allah. Allah is going to test us with our wealth. Allah is going to test us with our beloved family, with our wives, our children, our parents, our grandparents, our nieces, nephews, brothers, sisters, uncles, aunts, etc. He's going to test us. It's a part of life. When you are tested, show patience. Show patience in all of this with Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala. The first patience is with Allah. That you continue to pray. You continue to give sadaqah. You continue to do sadaqah, zakat al-mal. You continue to fast the month of Ramadan. You continue to do the things that you're supposed to do. Number two, be patient with yourself. Many times we rush to do things. Sit back. Understand. Make dua to Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala and allow Him to guide you. Make dua to guide you. Number three, the patience with others around us. Sometimes we're confused with others around us. If they leave you one day, know that if every single one leaves us, and the only one with us is Allah, you have everything. But if you have all the people, and you have everything, and you don't have prayer, and you don't have everything behind you from religious purposes, you have nothing. You have nothing. Just remember that. That everything that we do in this world is to meet Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala with a clean heart. And we're not saying, Ya Allah, forgive us with our good that we've done. Ya Allah, show us mercy because we believe that we've done some good. That's what we're asking. We're asking Allah to bless us with His forgiveness, with His mercy. May Allah subhanahu wa jalla wa ala make it easy for us. And please, make dua for my brothers and sisters. All over the world, they're suffering, Ya Khwan Islam. There's an open war in Islam. You agree with it, you disagree with it. Right now, we always try to cover up, we try to hide, we don't talk about it. We're doing Ramadan, we try to hide our Ramadan, we're trying to hide our fasting, we're trying to hide our religious beliefs. I'm telling you, I understand.
They openly show us kufr. They openly show us disbelief. Openly show them iman. Openly show them iman. Show them the light of iman. Show them what prayer feels like. Show them what this feels like having a community in a masjid. Show them that every single masjid, everywhere in the world is full on a Friday. On a Friday, but they can't even do anything on a Sunday. We're buying their churches. We're buying their synagogues. We're buying their Hindu temples. Why? This is the religion of Allah. With all the negative rhetoric, Allah. Masjid after masjid, school after school, institution after institution by the Muslims. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So remember, my brothers and sisters that are suffering in the world, make dua for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ease their pain and suffering. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gather us in the highest level of Jannah with our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma izz al-Islam wa muslimin. Allahumma izz al-Islam wa muslimin. Allahumma izz al-Mardwan wa marja muslimin. Allahumma izz al-Rahma al-Mawta wa mawta muslimin. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الاحياء منهم والاموات اللهم انك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عنا اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك واغنا بفضلك عن شرك اللهم انا نعوذ بك من الهم والحزن والعجز والكسل والبخل والجبن وضلع الدين وغلبة الرجال اللهم ارنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وارنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم اهد الاسلام اللهم ثبتنا على الاسلام اللهم نور قلوبنا بنور الايمان اللهم اتنا في الدنيا حسنه وفي الآخرة حسن وقنا عذاب النار اللهم ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين اللهم اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم اللهم لا تجعلنا من القوم الظالمين اللهم لا تجعلنا فتنة للقوم الظالمين اللهم هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا المتقين إماما اللهم تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين أقم الصلاة.